Huawei's new Mate 9 is a mighty 5.9-inch mobile, boasting a lot of firsts for the company. But does it serve as a suitable replacement to the ill-fated Samsung Galaxy Note 7, or does it try a lot of things without really succeeding?
So the box itself, typical Huawei, a nice chunky mother, certainly won't go unnoticed. And there you go, there's our first glimpse of the Mate 9. So as you can see, it's a bit of a palm filler, 5.9 inches. We'll have a look at that in itself in a minute, but for now we're just going to have a bit of a flick through the box itself, of course, because this is an unboxing, and Huawei boxes are actually bloody nice. So here we go. So first of all, of course, this feels like your typical power adapter and all the rest. This is actually a Huawei supercharge adapter. So basically it's Huawei's own version of like OnePlus's Dash Charge, Qualcomm's Quick Charge and all the rest of it. They guarantee that you can charge up your phone in like just over an hour, I believe it was, despite the fact that it's a mighty 4000 milliamp effort. So definitely on the big side. And on this half of it, we'll hopefully get the cables. Yep, there we go. So as you can see, of course, it's a USB Type-C. So you get your lovely bit of cable action there. You get some nice little bundled earphones, which look like they might chafe your ears somewhat with extended use. And what's this little mother? Oh, here we go. So we've got a Type-C adapter in here by the looks of it as well. Let's just peel that open and have a nice look. There you go, Huawei branded, of course. And there you go, yeah, it's the old USB to Type-C. Hopefully you can pick that up all right. So a little adapter if you've already got cable and all the rest of it. So, and on this side, this is just your bog standard, your pokey pin to actually get into the phone itself, to get into the SIM tray, and it's also got full microSD memory card support as well, which is lovely, so you can expand the storage. And oh, look at this, it looks like they've put in a little bit of a bonus shell as well, so you've got a protector there, which I'm assuming just snaps right onto the back there, adds a bit of extra protection if needed. So that's a nice little bonus feature, very much appreciated. And what do we have in here? Is this just the Bore and Warranty stuff? It is the Bore and Warranty stuff, but look at that, what a lovely little sort of soft pouch that it comes in. Tell you what, Huawei has stepped up its game when it comes to packaging yet again. There you go, that is lovely. That's almost as nice as the phone itself. So let's get rid of all that crap and look at the actual phone itself, because that's the part that we're obviously very interested in.
Well, first off, the Mate 9 is a serious full-on phablet. If you want a phone that's easy to handle or compact in any way, this isn't the mobile for you. On the other hand, if a massive display is one of your main requirements, then the Mate 9 is an obvious choice. At 5.9 inches, you'll struggle to find a bigger blower here in the UK. That said, the narrow bezels and impressively slender finish mean that the Mate isn't much bigger than many other handsets such as the OnePlus 3, which have smaller screens. You can tell that the Mate 9 is a premium device with just a quick fondle too. The aluminium unibody looks pleasingly sleek, with subtle chamfered edging and some lovely detailing around the camera lenses. It's not waterproof, but it's pretty rugged at least. Chris has dropped our review sample a couple of times and it still hasn't got a scratch on it. Of course, one-handed use isn't exactly a walk in the park. The Mate 9 is a hefty and rather enormous handset, which demands 2 mitts for proper operation. However, Huawei has added a fair few features to make one-handed use possible.
This is the first phone to rock Huawei's new Emotion UI 5.0. There it is there. What is Emotion UI, or EMUI for short? It's basically just Huawei's software that shoves on top of standard Android to give it a sort of distinctive Huawei look and feel. So in this case, we've just run on top of Android Nougat, the latest version. And yeah, just to basically make it more distinct from the likes of a Sony phone, a Samsung phone, add in some of Huawei's own features and the rest. And usually in the past, Huawei phones, we think, sexy bit of hardware, love the hardware, nice specs and all the rest of it. But the software, not so much. Emotion UI tends to be a bit glitchy, tends to be very irritating at times by doing simple things like removing some of Android's best features like the App Store, and the features that Huawei adds in are occasionally a bit so-so. But Emotion UI 5.0 has actually turned us from haters into proper fanboys. In fact, I would go so far as to say that this is one of the best launches of 2016 so far, and here's why. So basically, Huawei 5.0, we've changed the design ethos a bit, different aesthetics and the rest, but there's one main change that has made us absolutely adore it, and that is the addition of an apps drawer, something which has been removed from every single other version of EMUI for some reason.
And it's really annoying because I'm OCD about my desktops and stuff. I want everything sort of nice and tidy and organized. What I don't want is every single app of mine lumped on the desktops. Even if I can file it in folders, it's just messy. I don't want it. And there's lots of apps that I use occasionally, but you know, not that often, but not enough to delete them off the phone and re-download them every time I want them. So now we've got an app store where we can file away all that stuff and just access them all with a quick tap, which is just lovely. It doesn't come activated by default. You do have to go into settings, go to home screen style, and then there's an option in there for the drawer. But you know what? Just having that option makes it so much better. Honestly, my kecks were damp with delight when they said that that was going to be a thing. So that is beautiful. As well as the overall aesthetics and everything, there's been a bit of a concentration on ease of use. So Huawei reckons you're no more than three taps away from every single feature you need. Made especially easy by the fact that Android's settings menu is now a lot more easy to navigate. You can skip in between the different settings nice and simply. But of course, general ease of use has always been sort of quite key with Android. Everything's fairly easy to navigate and find, unlike iOS, where occasionally I'm stabbing through menus for about 10 days before I finally find what I need. Although even that's getting better with iOS 10, thank God. Also, Huawei is concentrating on missed taps as well, because obviously some of Huawei's phones are a bit big, like the Mate 9. It's a bit of a handful at 5.9 inches. And occasionally you'll be stretching for something and, oh, look, you've accidentally opened up an app. And that just goes to prove that it's not 100% perfect, unfortunately. You do occasionally strain at the screen, and it can't detect, obviously, then, because I hadn't quite reached the other side of the screen, that was a mistap. But thankfully, there's a good way around all of this issues, and that's the one-handed use. You see, Huawei has made it incredibly flexible to use this one-handed with Motion UI 5.0. So for instance, you'll see at the bottom here, I've added this little pull-down button, so it pulls down the notifications menu. With just a quick tap at the bottom of the screen. So that's much easier to reach with your thumb than reaching all the way up to the top of the screen and dragging down the notifications tab every time. We've also got lots of other options as well. So for instance, there's the new slide gestures features, which use the fingerprint sensor here on the back. And what you do, just a quick swipe down of that, and it pulls down the notifications bar as well. Quick swipe up again, and it goes. And you can also double tap to remove all of your notifications. If one quick, easy gesture. So that's really good too. And also, there's the little one-handed menu option. So you can just pull down, drag your finger across the toolbar, either left or right, and it drags the entire screen down to the bottom of the phone, which is lovely. So again, you can now quickly and easily reach whatever you want, drag down notifications, hit settings, all the rest of it. And that works inside your apps as well. So for instance, you can do a bit of web browsing. There you go. Recombu.com/mobile, lovely website, recommend that one. And then just drag along like that when you're done. So again, much easier one-handed use. It's flexibility, that's the key. There is lots of different ways to use this easily one-handed. And the same goes for resource management as well. Dive into the settings, for instance, and we'll scroll down to memory and storage. And there's you know, some key features in here which show you exactly how much memory you're using, what have been the biggest hogs over the past day and all the rest of it. And then you can also go into storage cleaner and just quickly delete all of the junk files that have been sat there on your phone, taking up space. So that's nice and simple as well. And there's just lots of different little options like that. For instance, we can also go into recent apps. And in here, you'll not just see a list of all the apps that you've got open, you'll also see how much memory is being used up. And if we just tap the ones that we want to keep open, for instance, Chrome, YouTube, Gmail, let's keep those open, but close everything else. And then you just tap the bin button and hey ho! Everything else is closed down, and that's how much memory we've freed up, 124 megs, not to be sniffed at. So that's lovely. So again, flexibility is brilliant. And Motion UI 5.0 also adds in a couple of extra bonus features, such as, for instance, the dual login feature. So if you've got a couple of Facebook accounts, for instance, one that you tell all your friends and family about, have all your personal stuff on, and then maybe one that you keep super secret and hidden from everyone, you can log into both at the same time without having to constantly log out, log back in, log out, log back in. It's not perfect, unfortunately. I do find out that the accounts do occasionally log themselves out quite often anyway with this. So it kind of renders it a bit moot, but never mind. It's a nice to have, I guess, if anything else. Not everything else is a success in Motion UI 5.0 as well. For instance, you've still got the good old knuckle mode, which unfortunately sucks just as hard as it always did. So for instance, you're supposed to be able to drag your knuckle across the screen with an app open to open up multitasking view. But we find that we end up, oh, there we go, third time. My God, I'm glad I've got this on video, because usually it takes about 20, 30, 40 attempts, if I'm lucky, to get that open. But there you go, it did actually work third time. That never usually happens. Normally I'm dragging... Oh my god, first time! What is going on? This is some sort of Christmas miracle. Yeah, normally I'm like dragging... Oh my god, again! This is mental. What is going on? Normally I'm there dragging for hours trying to get it to work. And now it seems to be working first time every time. Therefore making my point invalid. Normally knuckle mode sucks. Today it's been absolutely gorgeous. Maybe there's been some sort of software update overnight that has made it less crap. But that's brilliant. But of course, again, flexibility is the key. So if you can't get knuckle mode to work, luckily all you have to do is long press the recent apps. And there you go, you're again into multitasking mode. So it's all good. So there's, even if a feature sucks, there's generally some way around it.
That 5.9-inch IPS display is certainly spacious. But does it also pump out pleasing visuals? In short, yes. The Full HD resolution is a bit of a surprise given the Quad HD display fitted on the Porsche design model, but the Mate's panel is still pleasingly sharp, to the point that you'll struggle to spy any individual pixels. You can have a play around with the colour temperature and some other basic settings in the display menu, but there's not a great deal of customization on offer. However, you do at least get the eye comfort mode, which filters out blue light when you're in a dimly lit environment, for an easy on the eyeball viewing experience. You also get a microSD memory card slot to expand the 64GB of onboard storage, giving you buckets of space for your media collection. The Mate 9 comes with the latest version of Android, Nougat, and Huawei's brand new EmotionUI 5.0 is slathered on top to change up the overall look and feel of Google's OS. This is the first version of Huawei software launcher that we actually like. As for hardware features, you get a fingerprint sensor mounted on the back, and it's one of the best we've used this year. Despite being rather tiny, certainly in comparison to the phone itself, the scanner is easy to find with your finger when you pick the phone up. It's pleasingly accurate too, only throwing up errors when your finger is wet or dirty. You also get an IR blaster built into the top edge of the phone, which is a feature we haven't seen on many other phones at all recently. It's far from a deal clincher, but it's nice to have as an extra means of controlling your gadgets. There's no doubting the Mate 9's chops when it comes to performance. That Kirin 960 processor is an absolute beast, easily rivaling the likes of the Snapdragon 821 when it comes to running your apps, playing games, and everything in between. Multitasking is a pain-free process, helped by that massive screen, of course. You can quickly get two apps running side by side with a split screen effect, and we're yet to see any kind of slowdown whilst doing so. Meanwhile, the latest games play with a perfect frame rate and look fantastic. You shouldn't see any kind of performance issues for the full 2 years of a phone contract, but even if the Mate 9 did start to creak a bit, EmotionUI 5.0 includes plenty of simple ways to free up memory and speed things up. Battery life is another definite highlight. The Mate 9 has a massive 4000mAh cell squished inside, which is bigger than pretty much every other phone battery from 2016. Combined with the relative efficiency of the Mate, you can expect around 2 full days of life from a single charge, even with video streaming and gaming thrown in. The Mate 9 can also be quick charged in roughly 90 minutes using the provided supercharger and a Type-C USB cable.
Huawei's partnership with optics expert Leica is well and truly blossoming, and now we have this second generation dual lens snapper packed away inside the mighty Mate 9. This time you get a 12 meg RGB lens as well as a 20 meg monochrome lens, which work together in perfect unison, kind of like He-Man and She-Ra, to produce mind-blown results, or at least that's the theory. The Mate 9's camera app is packed with features and therefore looks pretty cluttered. But no worries, it's actually easy to use once you get your head around it. On the right edge, you get the shutter button, a video shortcut, and the gallery shortcut, while over on the left side, you get several quick access settings. These include the obvious ones like a flash toggle and a button to swap between the front and rear cameras, as well as the obligatory filters. On top of that, you get Huawei's Vivid Colors mode, which boosts a photo's vibrancy, plus the wide aperture mode for those beautiful bokeh shots. Now that's more than enough for the average user to contend with. But if you flick your finger right across the screen, you'll also open up a full menu of camera modes. These include a wide range of bonus features, from a beauty mode to hide those sags and wrinkles, to Huawei's trademark light painting tool. Flick your finger left instead, and you open the general camera settings menu. And from here, you can fiddle with the photo resolution, GPS tagging, timer function, object tracking, and so on. If it's manual controls that you're after, they're present and correct too. Swipe that little arrow beside the shutter button and you'll pull out the Pro toolbar, which includes the likes of an ISO control, white balance levels, and a manual focus override. If you're a bit of a photography whiz who demands an extra bit of control, that'll do you nicely. In good quality lighting, the Huawei Mate 9's camera is impressively fast to capture your photos. Just tap the shutter button and your shot takes pretty much instantly, while long pressing the button fires out a series of snaps using Huawei's burst shot mode at a seriously impressive rate.
The Mate 9 does a good job of focusing with respectable light thanks to the smart tech working with the lenses, including phase detection and laser autofocus. Results are usually excellent when viewed back on a big screen. Colours are naturally reproduced or given a subtle but pleasing boost if the vivid colour mode is activated. Everything from up-close macro shots to sweeping landscapes are crisp and detailed, as you'd hope from the combined effort of those lenses. Even more impressive are your depth of field photos, where your subject is up close and the background is blurred out. That dual lens setup captures some truly beautiful bokeh with the wide aperture mode, which is definitely a step above the iPhone 7 Plus. However, like the last generation-like lens, the Mate 9's camera isn't quite as strong when the lights go down. If conditions are a little dim, you tend to get grainy shots. And if your subject is in motion, common with pets and kids of course, then you can expect a lot of blurry results. When compared with the likes of Samsung's Galaxy S7, the Mate 9 can't quite replicate that excellent low light quality. There's not a massive gulf between these phones, but there is definitely a subtle difference. This is the first Kirin pack in Huawei phone to boast 4K video recording, complete with a special compression feature to keep your home movies from filling up the Mate 9's storage space. You can also shoot in full HD with optical image stabilization enabled to cut down on judder and handshakes. Video quality on the whole is fine, if unremarkable. Our HD video samples boasted plenty of detail, while the focus quickly snapped into action when moving from near to distant subjects. However, changes in lighting conditions aren't always handled perfectly, and likewise the image stabilization is weaker than some rivals such as Sony's SteadyShot feature. There's still a fair bit of judder when walking and shooting at the same time, and even little tremors are present when standing still and filming. While the Mate 9 doesn't quite take the crown as best smartphone snapper of 2016, that dual lens Leica effort is still a solid all-rounder. It's fast and effective in good light, and only dim light sort of proves its undoing, while also video recording is decent if not remarkable.
The Huawei Mate 9 isn't quite the essential purchase that Samsung's Galaxy Note 7 was before the whole Bernie Screamy saga, but it is a very good supersized handset. Emotion UI 5.0 is fun to use, and you get all of the features you'd expect, including a solid camera and a gorgeous spacious screen for taking in media on the move. Factor in smooth performance and impressive battery life, and you've got a pricey but premium smartphone experience. Hopefully you enjoyed our review of the Huawei Mate 9, and if you want to see more, we have a metric ton of content on our YouTube channel. Don't forget to subscribe, and you can read more on recombu.com/mobile. Thanks for watching.